Okay, well, welcome back to the Windows 8.1 Design Jumpstart. In this session, we're going to be talking about contacts and appointments. And again, this entire morning or the last couple of sessions, we've been talking about contracts, how I can use contracts to participate in more complex scenarios, app-to-app scenarios, than I could on my own, or even extending or participating in Windows experiences like, you know, file open contact and file save contact and stuff like that. And contacts appointments is no different, right? This is an opportunity for me to participate in scenarios as well as drive usage or increase usage of my app. And what we're going to be talking about specifically is the contacts contract, which lets me integrate contacts from the People app into my app, as well as some of the actions that are associated with those contacts, like calling somebody or mapping their address or sending them an email, as well as working with appointments from the calendar app. So being able to add things to someone's calendar on the local machine and modify that item later. And doing this all in a way that makes users really feel like they're in control and their data associated with contacts in the People app and appointments in the calendar app are safe and secure. So let's start off by talking about the contact contract. And probably the best way to do it is just show the experience and give you a feel for what we're really talking about and from a user's perspective, what we're enabling. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to switch over here to the People app. And the People app is installed with Windows 8.1, and you'll go through the People app and you'll connect to all the different services that you have that have contacts, whether it's, you know, Exchange or Gmail or, you know, Outlook.com or Facebook and whatnot. And that integrates with all the different scenarios that you can associate with people, like, you know, sending them mail, posting, you know, in Facebook on your Facebook account and so on. And here's an example. So I've got a contact, Kim Abercrombie, and she's actually the fictitious person, and I've got, you know, all this contact information about her, right? And when I'm in this app, I can take actions like being able to, you know, send her an email, right? So this isn't just information. I can actually launch these scenarios and start a new mail, right? I can call her, right? And it's using whatever my default application is, you know, on this machine, and my default application for email is the mail app that ships with Windows 8.1. For calling, it's going to launch Skype and give me an opportunity to start a call with Kim based on the phone number for her, you know, mobile number or whatnot. Or even just mapping, right? So being able to map her address and get driving directions and drive time and traffic and stuff like that with the map app. And all of this works through file or app protocols associated with default apps. So you know, the People app knows that it's an email, it knows that it's a phone number or a tell URI, or knows that it's a map URI. And when I click on those actions, it launches the right app for me, right? So that's really, really powerful, because when I'm, you know, in the People app, I've got not only all the information I need about my contacts, but it also gives me all the actions that I might want to perform, you know, with a contact, like calling and sending email and so on. But what would be even more useful is if that was integrated into all the different apps that I use that have contact association with contact information and with people. So that's really what this particular contract is all about. So you can see here, I'm starting to, you know, create a new mail with Kim, right? And you can see I have my email address, and then, you know, I've said that I'm going to have this mail go to Kim. When I click on this link, and this is a code within my application, I can actually enable integration into that contact from the People app and the features associated with the People app directly into my app. And as we'll see here in a second, we're doing that in a way that's totally secure and confidence building for the user. Because what the user sees is, yeah, I have a contact, Kim, and when I click on that, I'm seeing the UI from the People app. And I store all my contact information in the People app, so I know this app and I trust this app. I mean, as we'll see here in a second, it's actually very secure for the user as well as for me as the app designer or the app publisher. But you can see here it's the same kind of UI that I can see all her contact information. If I want to click on, you know, more details, it'll take me right to the contact, right? But even more importantly, if I click on this, I have all those same actions like directly in my app. And of course, I'm in the email app, so, you know, maybe sending an email doesn't make sense. But, you know, being able to do a call directly from my app is a great scenario. And there's a couple of cool things that are going on here is that I have integrated all of that contact information from the People app directly into my app. And all the actions that are available for those contacts are also available to my app. So what makes this really, really cool is, you know, I was, and this could be, you know, a link behind a name or a picture in my app or however I want to invoke this with code within my app. It's really up to me to design and for my development team to implement. But the thing that's really cool about this is that if you noticed here, I clicked on Kim's name, I saw the contact information, I decided that I wanted to call her, and I launched the call, and it launches in a windowing mode, right, where the mail app is still on the screen, and then I launch the call, I talk to Kim about whatever I wanted to talk to her about, and then I just push this off to the side, and I'm still in the mail app. So for me as a publisher, it's really, really cool in the fact that I've kept my app open, and I've kept my app as the focus of the user, right? So rather than, you know, if I didn't do this, what would happen? They would go, you know, over to the start screen, they'd start the People app, they'd start a call, and then they're outside of my app, right? My app is no longer running. So really, or it's not the focus anymore. So really, this is a great scenario from the perspective that I'm keeping my app open, available, user in focus and using my app, but I'm still enabling all those scenarios with contacts. So it's something that you should really think about when you're thinking about your app and how you work with contacts, because doing that integration gives you the ability to not only integrate that data seamlessly in a really great experience for the user, but for me as an app publisher, it keeps my app open and running and the user focused on that app. Okay, so how does this work? Well, the contact contract is all about integrating the People app and contacts within the People app within your app. So People is the one app that Windows 8.1 users to manage all their contacts in a single place, coming from many different sources, whether it's a social network or address books and so on. And it provides, you know, an integrated feed of contact activity as well as, you know, search for contacts and those actions for contacts like being able to, you know, launch mail or call or map and whatnot. So what does the contract do? Is the contract, I'm going to say that so many times, it's going to come across as being contract. So the contact contract brings people integration into apps, right, in a way that feels safe and secure and confident for users because, you know, they know the People app and they trust the People app. When that UI pops up, it doesn't look like the People app. It actually is the People app. And we'll see that here in a second. And what's great for me as an app publisher is I don't have to, you know, manage and store and secure contact information. I also don't have to, you know, convince users to give me their contact information. With this integration between People and my app, all the information is in the People app that I trust and know, but it's being integrated into my app. So it just feels like, yeah, there's my People app contact for Kim, right? So it's a great story for users. As well as a great story for publishers. And again, it's an opportunity to have that contact information and more importantly, some of those actions integrated into your app in such a way that it keeps users in your app. They're not going to the start screen and starting the People app and forgetting what they were doing, you know, in your app. Okay, and this is just an example of doing that integration where, you know, I would go into settings and I would say add account and I would add all the accounts that I have like Facebook and Twitter and my Outlook account and Google Connect and LinkedIn and so on. And that gives me all of the contacts like Ben Miller here where I can have that integrated experience of being able to, you know, send him a message through Skype or send him an email, map the address, view his profile on Facebook and, you know, integrate his feed from different social networks and stuff all within that app, right? And then being able to provide that same experience in my app as a publisher is really, really important. And like you'd seen here, like behind, you know, the name Ben Miller in the mail app here on the left, I can just click on that and have that show the contact card for Ben Miller. And if I'm, you know, used to using the People app, I can see that that's actually, you know, the same UI that I'm familiar with that I use every day for my contacts coming across all those different sources. And one of the things that's really interesting about this that you'll notice is that the background color for the People app on the right side is obviously this orange, or dare I say, chartreuse.
Ooh.
Wow. And on the left, it's obviously integrating in with the color of the Mail app with kind of that bluish green. And I wish I had a fancier word for that, but just right now it's escaping me.
That's okay.
So, yeah, no problem. So it looks really integrated in it, and it looks really seamless in the app, even though that contact card, that flyout, is a completely separate application. That's actually the People app, just as a flyout on top of my app, in this case, you know, like the Mail app. Okay? So what's the user experience? Well, anytime I'm showing information about a user or have information about a user, you know, it makes sense for me to add to that an ability to show contact information and integrate those actions associated with the contact card. Because again, you know, it provides a seamless experience for the user. It's very, very fast and fluid, as we've been talking about for the past couple of days. And the other thing that's great about it is it keeps people in my app. If they just want to get some information about, you know, Ben, or maybe launch a call and then, you know, push Skype off to the side or push the mapping app off to the side, they're still in my application. So here you can see that there was a hyperlink that I attached to the contact card. Okay, so it's very contextual. It's also very consistent with the People app, that people know that's where I store my contacts. And it's consistent with that contact card experience. When you see them side by side, they're very similar because they are, you know, the same app. And then users have confidence that this is the People app that they know and they trust when they see that contact card, because it is that same kind of branding and the same kind of layout that they're used to with the other app. And again, this is just a lightweight flyover UI that comes on top of your app. The users, you know, either interact with it by taking actions or light dismiss by, you know, tapping or touching someplace else on the UI, and it just dismisses, right? Just like an app bar or a flyout. Okay. And again, this is something that's really about user control. When you think about, you know, how many issues we've had in the past with apps like collecting information and using it in a way that the user isn't comfortable with. And here you can see a quote about users, you know, declining to install or uninstalling apps because they don't trust the app with their people information or with their contact information. Or, you know, heaven forbid, you know, a situation where an application uses that information in a way that the user isn't comfortable with. That can be like a really, you know, a big barrier for us as app publishers. But what I can do is, again, integrate that people information or that contact card information into my app, and I never have to ask for that trust, right? They trust Windows, they trust the People app. I can just leverage that and integrate that into my app, and it's really secure for the user, it's really secure for me as an app publisher, because I don't have to worry about, one, you know, getting the permission, and then two, keeping the trust, right, of securing and storing that contact information. So contact source, let's talk about what it's like to be a contact source and that workflow associated with the contact card. And where it starts, obviously, is the user on their machine using Windows and populating the People app with contacts by connecting it to, you know, their Exchange server or their personal email account or the different social networks they use and so on. And then me as an app publisher, the source app, like the Mail app, anytime I show somebody's name or their picture or so on, I might want to show contact card information or integrating that contact card and the information as well as the activities that's associated with that. And what I'm actually doing there is when I'm asking to show a contact card, I'm actually just talking to an API of the Windows runtime. And I'm supplying enough information to show the contact card, like providing like an email address or a name or whatever. And that call to contactmanager.showContactCard is a query where I'm just passing the information that I know about the contact and asking for the Windows contact store to look it up for me. And that flyout that's actually shown, there's never any information that's passed back to my app. So me as the app publisher, I never have to worry about, you know, securing or storing that information. The Windows contact store and that call to contact manager shows the flyout for me, and it does it in context of my app. It's just a flyout on top of my app. And then that gives the user control over what they want to do with that contact, whether they want to take an action, like clicking on the call button, which for this particular situation, Skype is the app that's taking care of the tell URI. So that action and that object is get passed off to Windows as the default app for placing calls, and that's what launches the target app. In this case, it's Skype, right? So it's really a great story from the perspective of kind of that contextual integration and enabling that scenario that would be, you know, really hard for me to enable as an app publisher, while still putting the user in control and giving them that option to take the action on the contacts that they kind of know and trust from the People app. So when we're thinking about the contact card, when you look at it, there's really some great meaningful data and actions that are associated with that. So like email and call and message and video call and mapping an address or posting to a social network. And that richness comes through by connecting it to different services and the data associated with those services. Like if you have a contact in exchange that has an address, or you link to Facebook and you have a Facebook contact within there. And the great thing about this is those actions are meaningful. So it's not just, here's a phone number that I might copy and paste and launch another app. It's an actual action you can take, that you can click on that drop down and launch the call, which launches that default app for that experience, like placing a call for Skype. So being a contact card target is also important for me, because if I'm a mapping app, right, or I'm a telephony app, I want to be able to enable those scenarios to kind of participate in the other side of this equation. Okay, so how do I do that? Well, I want to design for contact-driven launch scenarios. So if I'm a mapping app, I want to make sure that I understand, you know, the protocol or the file extension that's associated with mapping, like map URIs or tell URIs for phone calls, or mail to for mail applications. And I declare that protocol and that file extension in my manifest. And then when the user installs that app, like installing Skype, you know, it'll ask me, do you want this to be the default app for placing calls? And when I answer as a user, because again, the user is always in control, yes, that links that call link in the contact card to the Skype application, right? So for me, I want to implement the right protocol or file extensions in my manifest, in my design, and think about those scenarios so I can be that app that gets launched, you know, every time someone's working with a contact, okay? And then within the code within my app, I'm backing that up to implement that design scenario around, you know, handling the launch activation and driving that to my scenarios or helping users complete those scenarios that are key to my particular, you know, great at statement, or what my app is, you know, really, really great at. Okay? So next let's talk about the appointments contact and integrating appointments from a user's calendar into my application. And it works really the same way that we had seen with people and contacts, where, you know, I have all these different apps on my machine that, you know, are associated with dates and with time. And then I've got my calendar application that's installed with Windows 8.1. And really what I want that to turn out to be is, you know, rather than having those siloed where every single app that I work with has a calendar in it, I'd rather just have it in my calendar, right? So if I use the calendar and link that again to, you know, my personal mail account and my work account and then Facebook with, you know, events and stuff like that, it's all in one place and I can manage it in one place. Because again, that makes me feel really empowered and really in control as a Windows user. And that's what the calendar app does with the appointments contract. So let's just look at a quick demo of this. So I've got, this is just a demo machine, so I have a blank calendar set up here. But you know, if I were to go through and connect this with all my different services, you would see all of my different calendar appointments here. And just for the, you know, respecting the privacy of all my friends and family and stuff like that, I'll just start with a blank calendar. But we've got an application here that is an SDK sample here in Visual Studio, and I'm just going to run this here. And this SDK sample uses the appointments SDK to add things to the calendar and add it in such a way that, again, the user's in control. So let's say that I wanted to, and this is just a quick, you know, Windows Store app SDK sample, you know, that a bunch of UI widgets to help me, you know, populate a created appointment. So watch what it does. So I'm going to go for an appointment at noon today. And the subject is going to be lunch, and the location is going to be the cafe, and the details, you know, let's go eat. Then I want to put a reminder in here. It's going to be 30 minutes because we're going to eat really quickly, and I'll put a reminder in here 15 minutes beforehand and set the status to busy and so on. And all these things that you would expect associated with creating an appointment, right? And I'm going to click on this create appointment button. And notice what it does is that it shows the same UI. It's actually, I shouldn't say same UI. It shows the UI from the calendar app as a flyout on top of this SDK sample. And you can imagine this being, you know, the app that you're working with as an app publisher. And you can see all the information here as far as, you know, who's sending it and what the subject is and the location and the time and notes and stuff like that. And when I click add here, it's adding that appointment to my calendar, right? So again, it's that great kind of symbiotic relationship between the user, the app, me as an app publisher, and the time information that I work with, and the calendar of the user, right? And I can, you know, store a unique ID for this calendar item if I want to go back to it and integrate it, you know, into my app, you know, behind a link to, hey, go see this, you know, event in the calendar, or being able to modify it later and so on. So let's look at how that works. So appointments, this is really analogous to what we looked at with the relationship between the people app and the contact contract, where the appointments contract is all about enabling integration with the calendar app. So me as a Windows 8.1 user, I've got a calendar in Windows 8.1, and I integrate that into all the different places that I store calendar information, like my Exchange server, my personal email, and social networks, and so on. Then I've got one calendar that kind of represents me and how I live and how I, you know, play and socialize and work. The appointment contract brings that calendar integration into the app. So again, users feel safe and secure and confident in the fact that it's calendar, right? The calendar app that they know. And then me as a publisher, I don't have to worry about managing and storing and securing calendar information, you know, for users. I can just do the integration that, again, keeps people in my app. Because, you know, they can sit there and say, hey, you know, here's this event coming up. Do you want to add it to your calendar? They click add. They see the UI. They confirm the action. And then they're still in my app. They're not, you know, going back to the start screen, launching the calendar application, saying new appointment and filling all the information in, and then maybe deciding to go to a different app, right? So it's a great way to keep people in my application. So what's the workflow here? Again, people start using the calendar app and either, you know, manually adding appointments or more likely connecting it to calendars that they already have, whether they're in social networks or personal email or work email. That populates the Windows appointment store. And then me as a source app, whenever I want to integrate into that calendar by, like, let's say, creating or adding a new appointment, I'm talking to the Windows runtime, right? So I'm not talking to another app or hardwiring to another calendar. I'm just saying appointment manager.showAddAppointment async, does it asynchronously, which shows a flyout populated with all the information that I wanted to provide. You can see here this is coming from the calendar app, but the color is keyed to match my application again so it looks seamless. And then I click the add button. That information is passed off to the target app so it can be added to my calendar. Okay? So that's contracts and appointment. Again, contracts are all about enabling broad scenarios by allowing apps to work together, whether that's, you know, two different apps from two different publishers or you interacting, you know, with Windows and participating in Windows scenarios. So the contact contract integrates apps into people. So it gives you that ability to say, hey, you know, all my contracts are in the people app, and I as an app publisher can integrate that information as well as those actions into my app and not worrying about, you know, securing or storing or managing any of that data. All right? And it keeps users in your app, which is a great story for me as a publisher. And appointments works the same kind of way, just but with calendar and appointments, I can build that appointment management into my app and put it into the calendar that the user really manages their life and the time and appointments within their life but still have it within my app. And doing that integration makes it really secure and confident for the user that that is their calendar. And I don't have to have a calendar in each app that I use, right? It's really, really seamless and really, really easy for me to think about my calendar as a user and as a publisher that adds value to my app.
And that really supports the win as one. So you're part of the system. And for the user, it's a complete system that he uses to manage his appointments and contacts and has its other apps there.
Right.
So it's a really integrated part.
Yeah, absolutely. So resources for this, I just provided a couple of links on the Windows Dev Center for the Contact Manager class and the Appointment Manager class, so you can see the capabilities of these APIs and how they work. And then let's do questions. So the calendar app lacks categories. What was the design decision behind this? Honestly, I haven't worked with the calendar team, so I don't know what the design decision was behind not having categories. That's good feedback, though. I'll reach out to the Windows team and let them know that that's something that people are interested in. Do we have other questions? Nope, that's it for today. Okay. Well, tell you what, so what we're going to do now is we're going to have a lunch break. So we're going to take, isn't it lunch break next?
No, we have a 10-minute break, and then we come back with tiles and notifications.
Tiles and notifications. Okay, so let's do this. Let's take a 10-minute break, and we'll come back, and Martin's going to talk about integrating into the start screen with live tiles and notifications and the lock screen. So we'll see you back in 10 minutes.
See you later.
Thanks.